Day. You now tuned in to the Def Fresh Show with Young Fresh.
Everybody, and welcome to another edition of the Definitely Fresh Show. It is I, Mr. Tone Deaf, both the Ghetto Prophet Mimi and Juan will be in the studio shortly. They're still recovering from the wonderfulness that is Wakanda, and yeah, we are definitely about to go in. So, giving you guys a heads up, if you have not seen the movie as of yet, first of all, shame on you. And secondly, this is going to be a spoiler show. So I'm giving you a heads up. If you don't want to know anything about the movie at all, turn away now. Don't listen. Don't tune in. Don't go back and listen to this again until after you watch it. Because we're basically going to break down the movie from beginning to end in all its blackness, all its gloriousness, the whole nine yards. So, yeah. Also, we're going to go ahead and also do a new little segment where we call Top Pop. So, basically, we'll give you our top five, whatever the hell we feel like talking today. So I think we're going to do top five black comedies. So for you guys out there listening, go ahead and put your top five comments in the comment section. If you're listening live on Spreaker, go ahead and put it on the Tone Deaf Radio like page. If you guys are listening to this via the SoundCloud app after it loads back up, go ahead and put it in the comment section down there so we can see exactly what your top five is. So while we're waiting for everybody to get in and get situated, let's go ahead and get back to a couple of more tracks off this Black Panther soundtrack so you guys can see the epicness that we've been listening to as well, too. All right. So we'll be right back.
I done came up, got my name up. So when they speak of who blinged up, I'm who they bring up. Come up dissing and you'll come up missing. I'm a cutthroat baller like O.J. Simpson. Little homie, listen, try and serve me. I put a 25 in your back like Barry Bonds jersey. On the streets, on the beach, y'all ain't able. Cause two, I shit on rappers like major labels. What's with the ice grilling, homie? Change your face. Cause he done do more to tan you to change your race. Girls love metaphor, and I love them back. Addicted to getting head, just call me the brainiac. Battle rap with words, war like jihad. I write dope, flow crack, my notepad need rehab. Fuck y'all CDs, y'all can't see these or touch these. Rhyme so chronic, my songs give you the munchies.
Country, king of my homeland, king of the filthy, king of the fallen, we living again. King of the shooters, looters, boosters, and ghettos popping. King of the past, present, future, my ancestors watching. King of the culture, king of the soldiers, king of the bloodshed. King of the wisdom, king of the ocean, king of the respect. King of the optimistic and dreamers that go and get it. King of the winners, district and geniuses with conviction. King of the fighters, king of the fathers, king of the belated. King of the answer, king of the problem, king of the forsaken. King of the empathy and resentment, king of remorse. King of my enemies, may they fall defeated. I rejoice, king of the skyscrapers, dodging haters, bro religion. Nine faces go against them, I erase them with precision. I embrace them with collision. Kings did it, king's vision. Black Panther, King Kendrick, all hail the king.
I dropped a million tears. I know several responsibilities put me here. I don't pedal backwards, but I live old-fashioned. The lens that I'm looking through won't prescribe you the right glasses. Masses are now free. Ashes I'm dumping out, about to spread all across seas. Sisters and brothers in unison, not because of me. Because we don't glue with the opposition, we glue with peace. But still a fuck up your organization if any beef. What do you stand for? Are you an activist? What are your city plans for? Are you an accident? Are you just in the way? Your native tongue contradicting what your body lands. Say, are you a king? Are you joking? Are you a king? Are you posing? Are you a king? Are you smoking bull rocks to keep you open? Because a king don't cry, king don't die, king don't lie, king get fall, king get by, king don't fall, kingdom come when I come, you know why.
King. I am T'Challa.
And we're back. Unfortunately, we have a little mix-up. They stuck on the freeway, so they'll be here shortly. But it doesn't matter because we still going to keep this party moving like we're supposed to move. So for you guys who know, like I said earlier, we were talking about the Black Panther movie. If you haven't seen it, people, go out and see it. There's a lot of different reasons why this movie is important for us to see. One of the biggest things is it is probably one of the first superhero movies with an all-black cast. Now, go ahead and answer some questions for people and debunk some theories real quickly.
He's the breakout star of the Marvel Cinematic Universe, but Black Panther is hardly new to superheroics. Since making his debut over 50 years ago, he's been part of countless comics adventures, and with that much action, there are bound to be a few odd bits that you've missed. Here's what you don't know about Black Panther. The first black superhero. Black creators were a part of comics from the very beginning. But on the page, things were drastically different. There were a few attempts at making comics directed at an African-American audience. But with the early days of superheroes, most black characters were sidekicks rooted in unfortunate racial stereotypes. In 1966, however, Stan Lee and Jack Kirby took steps to correct that by introducing a new character in their flagship title. Fantastic Four number 52 introduced the world to T'Challa, better known as Black Panther, king of the African nation of Wakanda. When he was asked about it, Kirby pointed to a very simple reason for creating the character. He realized there weren't any black people in his comics and thought that was a problem to be corrected. With that, the Panther was introduced in a story where he invited the FF to his secretive, ultra-high-tech homeland, only to take them all out in a massive battle in order to test them and find them worthy of helping them. Not a bad debut. Introducing the Cole Tiger. The version of T'Challa that hit the page in his first appearance sported the sleek, all-black costume that he's worn, with a few modifications ever since. Kirby's original designs, however, not only sported a different costume, but a different name, the Cole Tiger. As for how he wound up as the Black Panther, a lot of people erroneously attribute it to a connection with the activist organization of the same name. That's not the case. Stan Lee was inspired by an old pulp hero. The accidental association with the organization led Marvel to briefly change the character's name to the Black Leopard in 1972's Fantastic Four. Number 119. The Cole Tiger name wasn't completely forgotten, though. In the MC2 continuity, a version of the Marvel Universe set a generation after the current stories and mostly focused on Peter Parker's daughter, Spider-Girl, T'Challa's son, T'Chaka, used it as his own superheroic codename. The Panther fights the Klan. While the Panther would remain a fixture in the Fantastic Four for the rest of the 60s and would join the Avengers in 1968, the early 70s saw him launched into his first solo adventures. It happened in the pages of Jungle Action No. 6 and over the next 18 issues, which would tell one of Marvel's most lauded stories. The series reached its heights in No. 19. The Panther is pitted against the Ku Klux Klan. Set in Georgia, the story focused on Monica Lynn, a singer who became the Panther's longtime love interest and dealt heavily with racism. It's full of striking imagery, and one issue even ends with the Panther strapped to a burning cross. Before he frees himself, batters his way through the crowd with the wood still tied to his back, and returns to stomp a mud hole in the entire group. Good Vibranium. Comic books are full of special metals, but none are quite as interesting as vibranium. In the Marvel Universe, it's only found in two places, Wakanda and the dinosaur-filled Antarctic jungle known as the Savage Land. Wakanda's variety is known as True Vibranium, and its rarity is attributed to the fact that it's not actually native to Earth. Instead, the mountain from which it's mined is actually a massive meteorite. It has the ability to store and discharge vibrations, including the kind that come with a kinetic impact, making it able to withstand and even reflect energy. In addition to being used as part of Captain America's shield and even a few of Hawkeye's arrows, you can find it in the Panther's strength-enhancing bulletproof costume. The Dora Milaje. When Christopher Priest relaunched Black Panther in 1998, they delved into Wakanda and its culture in a way that hadn't really been done before. One of the most important additions was the idea of the Dora Milaje, translated as Adored Ones. The Dora Milaje are highly trained, highly effective warrior women who serve as the Black Panther's bodyguards. And the fact that they're protecting a bulletproof, super strong member of the Avengers should give you a good idea of just how tough they are. They have a second function, though, hinted at by their names. They're also potential wives. Each member of the Dora Milaje comes from a different faction, and as long as the Panther doesn't favor one over any of the others, peace is maintained. Which might be why, when he actually did get married, it was to Storm of the X-Men, rather than one of them. Everett Ross sold his soul for pants. If you've been paying attention to the Marvel Cinematic Universe, then you may already be familiar with Everett K. Ross, the CIA agent assigned to deal with some of the more official aspects of life in a universe full of superheroes. In the movies, he's played by Martin Freeman and made his first appearance in Captain America: Civil War. In the comics, however, he had a bit of a rocky start. As an agent working for the State Department, he was assigned to be a liaison to Black Panther during the hero's visit to America. Needless to say, the self-proclaimed King of the Useless White Boys was woefully unprepared to be pulled into the world of superheroics. After losing his pants in a mud wrestling match, Ross found himself visited by Mephisto, the closest thing that the Marvel Universe has to the devil, sitting next to each other in an apartment. With Ross on the couch and Mephisto on a flaming throne of skulls that he conjured up from the depths of hell, the two characters shared a moment when Mephisto granted Ross a new pair of jeans, leaving Ross wondering if he had accidentally sold his soul for pants. The Black Panther movie that wasn't. Superhero fans are undoubtedly familiar with Wesley Snipes from his role as Blade in the movie series of the same name, hitting screens in 1998. The movie not only gave Marvel its first cinematic hit, it also showed that second and third tier characters could be given a new life in film with the right idea behind them. But what even diehard fans might not know is that Blade wasn't Snipes' first attempt to bring a superhero to life. Long before Ryan Coogler took the helm with Chadwick Boseman, Snipes was dead set on playing the lead in a Black Panther movie. In the mid-90s, Snipes was in talks for a film that would use the fantastic, glorious periods of African empires and African royalty as the basis to bring an inspirational new superhero to the screen. He wanted Wakanda, vibranium, the force field, and the kind of comics-accurate costume that would require him to be, and we quote, just straight bodied up. Unfortunately, as we all know, there's always someone ice skating uphill. While Snipes met with director John Singleton and screenwriter Terry Hayes, the project never came together. Instead, Snipes went on to take a very successful risk as the Daywalker and says today that he supports the new film 1,000%.
Number one, this is not the first lead of a black person. T'Challa in Nation of Wakanda is so rich that they don't even give a monetary value on how much he has. And they kind of touch upon that in the movie as well, too, but it's definitely spoken upon in the comic book. So for those guys who are crazy comic book fans, and people know about folks like the Fantastic Four and Mr. Fantastic and Dr. Doom and Tony Stark's and even Professor X, and these guys are labeled as being geniuses and super smart people, and their intelligence supersedes anything that's out there. T'Challa is above that. Okay. When it comes to the actual powers of the Black Panther himself, it's a ritual. And that's another thing that I love about this movie. It actually did go and give us a look at the actual rituals that needs to be done in regards to how things are handled when superseding. So, unlike other superheroes in the comic book world, you're kind of given the mantle, or you take the mantle yourself. So you wake up one day and you create a suit of technological advancement, and you go out here and you call yourself Iron Man, and now you want to fight evil. Or someone creates this serum and you're one of the test subjects for it, and you just happen to be the one that gets it right, and now you have superhuman strength and abilities, and now you're Captain America. Or you just happen to be a god, and because you're a Norse god, you've developed these kind of abilities that supersede that of man, and you deem worthy for a hammer, and now you're the god of thunder. Or you just happen to be bitten by a radioactive spider, or hit with a radioactive bomb, you know. Or mutant, where this is not even something you asked for, you were born with it, it just happened. The Black Panther is not like that. The Black Panther literally had to go through a ritual. First of all, it is in the tradition of Wakanda that once a year, the king, now the movie doesn't go into depth in regards to this like the way the comics do, but every year the king, whoever the king is at the time, has an open challenge to anybody in the kingdom for the throne. You had to beat the previous king, and when you beat the previous king, you actually have to then turn around and beat six of his top warriors. Once you do that, then you become the new king. And of course, if you can't do this, the new king stays in place. But if you become the king, okay, at this point in time, you then go ahead and you go through a special ritual where you are then endowed with the powers of the Black Panther by taking the heart-shaped herb. Now you ask yourself, where in the world does heart-shaped herb come from? Well, the heart-shaped herb is a creation done by this vibranium meteorite. Okay? This is how Wakanda is so rich. So a long time ago, a meteorite actually crash-landed in Africa. The point when it crash-landed into Africa, it wiped out everything in the area, and only certain types of creatures repopulated there. Because of the radiation or the energy emitted from vibranium, it actually kind of advanced these creatures. As these creatures started to grow, mankind also noticed this, and during a brief war or the rise of man, they actually took down these creatures and killed them. When they did that, man came together to say, hey, these guys might come back, so let's all stick together. So four of the kingdoms came together, and they actually created the nation of Wakanda. Now, a fifth kingdom, my thought, didn't actually want to come in and join them in regards to it, but that fifth kingdom does play a major factor in regards to the whole Wakanda industry. And even then, those four kings that became part of Wakanda, they actually selected their king, who became the Black Panther, and was able to do everything that needed to be done there. So Juan finally made it into the building. So what's going on, dog?
Nah, man, you know, just left for Zamunda.
You think Zamunda is like Wakanda?
Zamunda, they probably somewhere nearby. I don't think they're right next to each other, because Zamunda had that money, but they didn't have that Wakanda money. You know what I'm saying?
So
Wakanda money
saying,
ran deep, bro.
That Wakanda cash is long.
That money is long. No doubt. So before you came in here, I was basically giving everybody a small little background to get you up to speed with who Black Panther is, what the Nation of Wakanda is, and debunked a couple of rumors, such as in the Black Panther Party came first, which it didn't. The fact that basically T'Challa, which is who the main character in the movie is, and how do you become the Black Panther to begin with. So, you know, got that covered. But what we're going to do is we're going to go a little bit more in depth in regards to the movie itself. Now, before we get into the movie itself, what did you think?
I thought it was dope. That was awesome. I don't really know what people didn't expect. Like, it's a Marvel. Marvel very rarely doesn't knock it out of the park.
True.
Like, I feel like anything that has a Marvel studio stamp, like, they're like, people listen, man, the difference between a damn Marvel movie and it coming from Marvel Studios.
Yeah.
Like, anything.
Prime example is Spider-Man.
Anything that's got Kevin Feige's name on it is a blockbuster. It's a hit.
True. I mean, if you want to go ahead and say that, if you look at a Spider-Man movie, only the last one has been officially done by Marvel Studios. And you notice a significant difference in the direction of the movie, because it was geared around the actual development of Spider-Man, whereas previous movies focused more on the comic book aspects of it, or the love story. Like, Mary Jane and Peter is what we're going to focus on, because people want to see love stories. So yeah, it is a big difference. It is a big difference. What did you feel about the world of Wakanda? Because that's where I was at in regards to it, and how the movie represented the country as a whole.
I think that the movie did the comic book justice. Cause like when you
have you ever read any of the comic books?
I haven't read Black Panther comic books, but like I watch like a lot of, you know, stuff on YouTube where they give you kind of like a backstory, and they always had like pictures of what Wakanda looks like, and it was nice that they took what was in the comic book and brought it to life. Then on top of all the CGI and special effects that we could do in movies now, with it being 2018 and our technology is more advanced than, you know, back when they was doing Blade.
True. Blade and Spawn, and because Spawn needed, man, that could have been a great movie if it had the technology we have now.
Yeah, right. If they was to do Spawn in 2018, Spawn would probably be dope.
I think it'll be dark as hell though. Like it'll be dark.
But
I don't mean,
you know,
like you can't see, but I mean like niggas would die gruesomely.
No, Spawn had to be rated up. But you know what I was kind of thinking like after watching the movie?
What?
I could have totally seen Angela Bassett playing Storm.
You've been saying that for the past 24 hours. So answer me this question. Why do you feel that? Not going to answer.
No, I had to put you on mute because I was yelling at my little brother.
Okay. I had a feeling it was something like that.
No, no. I mean,
but why? I just don't know. Why? You've been on that lately. Why? Why do you feel that?
Well, for one, knowing the comic book aspect of the Black Panther, we all know that he was married to Storm at one point in time in his life.
True.
Because Storm is also based off of an African character.
Correct.
So I feel like had they would have noticed that way, maybe Storm could have been Angela Bassett. Now, I mean, maybe Storm and Black Panther could have been in the Marvel Cinematic Universe, had, you know, stars aligned, the X-Men originally been Marvel, not a Fox thing.
And that's what I was getting ready to say. Had the Fox deal went down a year ago, Nikita would have been cool.
And just looking at Angela Bassett's makeup of like look at how she got in shape when she did Tina Turner.
I don't think that's in shape, bro. I just think that's her naturally now. I think that's just old black sexiness, dog.
You just think she cocked diesel, man?
I think that's just her now, bruh. Like, after, right, you know, when people get to a certain age, they gotta do natural stuff to stay healthy. Like, after you, like, a certain age, you gotta go to the gym. You ain't been to the gym none of your life. You hit, like, 45. You ain't got no choice but to go to the gym if you wanna stay, you know, you wanna stay okay. I think that's where Angela Bassett is in her life, where she just got to take better care of herself, so she's just there already.
Right. So, like, when you look at the makeup of Storm as far as comic book, Storm wasn't no punk.
No, and you know what? That brings up a good point. There is a comic. There's a special comic out there where Storm is evil. And he took down the X-Men and took over Wakanda. Yeah.
So, you know, I wouldn't mind seeing, you know, Storm or Angela Bassett play Storm. Angela Bassett is fine, man.
Yeah. What y'all now, that also takes me to one of the points that I want to touch tonight. Did you know that the character that Angela Bassett plays, Siri's mom, is actually King T'Chaka's second wife? So that's not T'Challa's mom. That's a stepmom.
Oh, and since I was here earlier, I don't know if you did this already. Can we give it up for Michael B. Jordan?
No, I'm getting there. I didn't touch on it just yet on purpose, because that's going to roll into our first serious topic. So yeah, to me personally, the world of Wakanda looked stunning. Like Juan said the other day, they did a great job with Atlanta.
Atlanta looked really beautiful.
Atlanta looked really beautiful. I can fuck with that. The one thing about Wakanda that got me, though, and I think I said it when we got the movies, they were very well dressed for them to not have on shoes, and Wakanda having dirt roads. There was a part where they showed the market square of Wakanda, and the market square was just basically any typical old school market where it's like, yeah, like a spot meet. But if you've ever been to any foreign countries or seen any movie where people go to foreign countries, it's like a dirt road. Vendors are all on the side of the road, kind of like how the malls are, and you just bargain and sell from right there. But we're talking about cats and three-piece suits and women in, like, top-notch after seven dresses on. Just out here shopping like it wasn't shit. And that kind of threw me off. But it was cool. I'm like, well, how niggas roll? Speaking of your boy, since we now getting ready to roll into our first serious topic about this movie, if you had to rate Michael B. Jordan's performance as a villain on a scale of 1 to 10, where would you put him?
I don't really think Michael B. Jordan was a villain, though.
But that's where I'm getting at.
No, I don't really think he's. I think he was just a little radical in his message. Like, I think him and T'Challa had the same viewpoint. T'Challa just wanted to go a different way. Michael B. Jordan, like, no, we gotta do it this way and make him understand that it wasn't the slow method. He's kind of trying to do it by force. Because, you know, I mean, I saw his point. Like, I saw both sides of the ball. I saw what they tried to do. I really did.
Right. All right, so for those of you guys who haven't seen the movie, like I said, we already told you, it's a spoiler movie. We're not cutting before we tell. Michael B. Jordan was the antagonist, as somebody put it, because he really wasn't a villain. He is the character in the previews that has on the gold-like panther suit. We thought that he may have just made his own suit, but in actuality, it was one suit that was already originally created for the Panther, but he opted to not go with it because of it's too flashy. Michael B. Jordan, like I was telling you earlier, how you could only win the rights to be king via trial. Because of his nature of him actually being family, spoiler alert, people, getting ready to tell you. Michael B. Jordan is actually...
How you know everybody listening and watching the fucking movie yet? Like, damn, at least let the fool...
Because when you wasn't here, Wait a minute, Mimi. Be quiet for a change. Had you been here when the show first started, the very first thing I said was, if you are listening right now, this is a spoiler show. Tune away. Don't listen.
Okay, but
you're giving
the
away.
People who just tuned in like I just tuned in.
Didn't that
happen? Well, I ran into my daddy's friend and that motherfucker talked with me. Yes.
I tagged also on the post. I tagged it also on the live post that this is the show about Black Panther and it has spoilers. So, if
you
still click on it.
When you post this on iTunes, SoundCloud, I feel like you need to say the Death Fresh Show from Wakanda. I feel like you should say that. I don't know.
You know what? I planned on posting it on Wednesday. That way, it's the initial cutoff period that we give every show to watch a movie. That way, if you haven't seen it, you have until Tuesday. But the people on air want to see it. Right. That's what I said. That's why we give Wednesday the cutoff period. Like, if you ain't seen it by Wednesday, then you just get spoilers on purpose.
Nigga, I done seen it 3 times in 3 days.
What the hell?
I went with y'all Thursday. I went with my guy last night. And then I took the girls today. I done seen it 3 times and I'm not mad about it.
If I would have seen Tamina's post, before we came back from the gym, I would scoop the tickets off of her and win again. But it's just that good to see it again, people. See? And you know, Mimi don't like to do things too often. But 3 times? Yeah. That's a good thing. All right. So, tuned in at the correct time. We already talked about Wakanda and how beautiful it looked and how great of a job they did with making the city look itself. Start talking about Killmonger, aka Michael B. Jordan. How did you feel about his character?
I like he's a big ass nigga, but at the same time, it's like,
why did you feel he was a big ass nigga though? Because
of how he went about it.
Okay. Go into a little bit more depth.
I feel like there's a better way that you can handle things, but you bitter about shit. Like, you mad at everybody knowing that the nigga that killed your daddy gone, right? You know he's dead. That's why you there. You're like, alright, well, I'm gonna tell. Oh shit, I'm gonna challenge this motherfucker to be king and shit. And you heard him telling you, like, your daddy wasn't no king, murderer. But the way that he went about everything, choking the lady and shit, man, burn off this shit. Like, he was just a bitch ass nigga. There was no cause for that shit. He's just a bitch ass nigga because he felt like he could be a bitch ass nigga. There's plenty of people that have hard lives and lost parents and shit. They wasn't fucking bitch ass niggas.
But okay, let's look at it like this. Okay, I gotta play antagonist for him. He was forced to live in Oakland, California during the rise of gangs, during the crack epidemic, during police brutality. Meanwhile, the guy who killed his dad, his uncle, is living high on the horse in one of the richest countries known to mankind and left him. Okay? Him and his mama. So who knows the struggle he went through? I think it was more so not the fact that he went through all this, but the fact that he knew there is a country, my people, who could fix all this.
Well, that's how daddy felt. That's how daddy felt.
Right.
And I mean,
so you gotta look at, he's taking his daddy's mentality, adding on to that. So like, when your parents teach you something, you believe it. That's why you get all these Bible thumping kids who do everything that their parents say until they realize, what the fuck have I been missing? You know?
Okay. Okay. So, we'll put it this way. Now, you know that the fucking, his dad betrayed him, right? So,
he betrayed the old age, yes.
They bring his boy home. Right. His daddy was a traitor, betrayed the whole fucking nation. So, do you feel like that was really, really, really T'Chaka fuck believing dog there? Like, he could have just told him the truth. Like, look, this nigga sold us out. He's the reason why everybody got fucked up. Because the main nigga who was on his side was who? Who's the main nigga that was on Kill Number 5? The nigga who lost his parents and was real mad about Carl, right? Yo, I'm talking about Michonne.
What's his name? I just had his name written somewhere.
Dude from Get Out. Daniel
Wakabi. Wakabi. Yeah,
right. He was the main nigga riding on Killmonger Nuts. But don't realize that it was his daddy that even set that shit up with Carl. They killed his parents in the first fucking place.
Facts.
No, well, I don't know. Killmonger.
That's deep.
But it's
saying,
true.
If you go hold what a motherfucker parents did against them, then your daddy the one that's over there killing motherfuckers anyway. He set them up with the motherfuckers to steal all that shit and blow motherfuckers up.
Well, you so, he rolled with Killmonger because.
But
you
gotta remember, he rolled
with Killmonger. No, you gotta remember, he only rolled with Killmonger because he did something that T'Chaka and T'Challa never did. Like, you gotta remember, Quan was on the run for like 30 years.
Because he didn't know the truth. He didn't know the truth. He didn't realize that, okay, before they even got a chance to bring this nigga home, the very nigga who I'm praising for killing him is the nigga that stole him from the motherfucker that was supposed to bring him back in the first place.
It's true, but that's, you know, he only can go based on like, hey, your dad been promising you all these years and nobody's doing nothing, so I think it's time for me to do
it. And
you gotta remember, you also gotta remember, Wakabi wanted to roll. Wakabi wanted to help everybody anyway. Like in the beginning, when they was out in the yard just chopping it up, they was like, hey man, we should start helping other people. You know what I'm saying?
He was ready to bounce. They gonna bring problems with them. He said, if you let refugees in, they gonna bring their problems with them. He didn't want the motherfuckers there either. He said, then Wakanda
he didn't want
them
there, but that didn't mean he didn't want to help them. Like, well, you know, let's do a little take over.
On the side, I would just like to say, Captain America might be the realest nigga in the Marvel Cinematic Universe.
Why?
I feel like
they
should have
Iron Man willing to take it to the
ground. But then again, Bucky was in Wakanda and he already knows he can't kick the Black Panther's ass. It is noted that Cap has whooped Cap's ass
That was just a side note, though. Cap was willing to take that secret to the grave that Bucky was icing in the pan.
But I feel like at that point, when he first brought him in there in the throne room, when he told him, like, I did something your king couldn't be done, he should have busted the guy, like, right there, like, motherfucker, you the one that busted him out. When we had it, you the one that broke him out. Why he didn't tell motherfuckers that then?
Dollar had a chance.
And then it's like, okay, your daddy didn't get a proper burial, boo-hoo. But if they knew what he did, was he gonna get a proper burial anyway? Because he was a fucking traitor and he sold everybody out. So was he gonna get one anyway?
He would have at least got a fair trial. He would have did the time, and then he could have renewed himself as a person of the community. The reason for it wasn't a bad reason.
He was too nice, too. T'Challa was too nice as a king. Like, when he was
always been a nice person.
I'm just saying.
That's all he said. It's hard for good men to be king. He told him that.
When he was in handcuffs, he kept saying, what? He kept saying, ask me what my name is. Because he checked all the old niggas in the room. Like, hey, I said, shut up. Don't ask me what his name is. I know who he is. Get him off my team. Since he checked everybody.
But he was also still in his chest that he found out his dad killed his brother.
Hell yeah, he left a poor kid behind. Could we have
the same thing? I mean, no, that's real. Dude, you gotta remember, y'all, that's some real shit to happen. Like, what if something happens to your family? And Mimi and them just like, well, Wad will be okay. You're gonna be mad at the rest of your family when you find out, like, the niggas knew you was in this situation and they left you anyway.
What?
Did anybody remember Kill Bill when she killed Vivica Fox and she told her? And she was like, look, if you feel like you wanna come looking for me later, I'll be waiting for you type shit. Okay, you bring this motherfucker home and then he find out that you the one that killed his daddy. You think he ain't gonna try to overthrow some shit? Do you really think that it would have been safe to bring him back home?
He's tabs on him. Keep him educated. You know what you're supposed to keep your enemies? They say keep your enemies close.
Ain't
that what they say?
I feel like they would have
keep your friends close, keep your enemies close.
They would have went through the same thing had they brought this nigga home anyway.
I don't think it would have been so severe because think about it. Because he had so much time to let that hate fester, this nigga went and joined Special Ops. This nigga went to MIT. This nigga killed enough people to have a body full of tattoos. Okay, he could have been minimized, he could have been rectified, and it would have been done.
You are not really. He killed Wakanda first.
He wouldn't have had that much smart.
But okay.
Or maybe even the dad would have been like, you know what? Let me sit you down and let me tell you what happened. Let me tell you why I did this. So at least you know. That way, if you want to go over and come at me, you come at me like this. But it's out there. It's done. The fact of the matter is, like, the dad left him because. Of course, you couldn't bring the mom because the mom would have been an outsider. So he left him. It was all around. It was a whole fucked up situation. Okay, it was. But
I just
a lot
feel
of
like
people
it
said
was
that,
a
like I said, well, he wasn't a villain. He really wasn't a villain. He was just blind. Blind rage. Can y'all agree to that?
Oh. I
like how
he was still a terrorist fan.
I like how they threw the swerve in on this guy. Like, I really didn't think that he was actually going to throw ball on the side of a cliff.
I didn't see that coming either, but it did open
Killmonger
up.
Killmonger just a black Loki, fam.
Yeah, he threw that nigga off the ledge, and that really just set the precedence for everything. But how do y'all feel about the way he went out, though? Like, after the epic fight, down in vibranium mind, Bro took the stab, and the message at the end of he would rather be dead than be in chains. Because we all know he's going to get a trial. He's basically going to go to jail.
He's
going to
get a Tupac. That's how Tupac went out. Everybody gonna get quiet.
Like,
they don't remember how Tupac died in Juice.
Well, Tupac died in Juice because Omar Epps just had sweaty palms.
No. Okay, well, man. Tupac heard the sirens and he let go. He was gonna help him up. His brother died in Juice.
Or was he?
The mob.
Or was he? Did he purposely drop him because he knew that he was gonna come back and this nigga needs to be stopped? Because let's be honest, this should be crazy.
Oh, stop overthinking, bro. You wasn't gonna let this man die.
Man, this should be crazy, bro. I might have dropped this. Thank you.
Tom, you also a terrible nigga, but ain't much you want.
I said I might have dropped Bishop. Bro, he done, he shot three. He shot two of our homies. He got the Major League book. He was coming.
He didn't give a, he didn't give a damn about Rodney.
Man, enough about him. All right, back to what we talked about here. Because I wasted all the movie earlier. So, let's go ahead and let's switch up things a little bit here. Name a track that you feel would be on Claw's mixtape.
Make it right.
Oh, because he geeked about making it rain. Like, I really made it rain.
One hand.
That shit was crazy, though.
Like, dog has a SoundCloud leak and everything. What if Marvel actually legitimately put a SoundCloud link up for dude?
I would hate Marvel for that.
Could you?
Yeah,
what if it's fire?
I doubt it.
You never know, bro. Kendrick worked on the soundtrack, but Kendrick will probably work on the mixtape. The same.
Bro,
that hit track you don't know about.
I don't
want to. So how do you guys feel about the way they referred to anybody that wasn't Wakandan? As colonists, as outsiders, as basically everything disrespectful, with the exception of white people. Those guys who did see it, and you were stupid enough not to stay at the very end.
Nope.
If
they were stupid enough to leave, they don't deserve enough.
And then the Black Panther said, "Fuck that man." Oh, so you calling yourself the Dark Knight?
Really, nigga?
Did Hillary teach you how to name names?
Let me guess. You got hot sauce in your utility belts.
You wanna be me so bad!
You're what I'd be if I had no power.
And they praise you for your non-miraculous mediocrity.
You let the world know when you fucking be a hero.
As long as you're born rich,
it seems privileged. It's the only thing super about you. Your writers reward your underachievement.
Well, we must be twice as good
for half the panel. So, not only will I beat you in chess,
despite me going first every time,
my soul be bonded with the Panther God.
The ethereal fist race got my heaven.
Fuck a Batmobile. I got a black man on Bill on suicide door to the kill switch.
Cat Becky, Cat Woman, keeps burglarizing you while me and my queen take this world by storm.
Fuck a Banat Butler.
Get him.
I got a big mama left in. Been there, done that, and Bible.
They say I just might be a black Bruce Wayne in the making.
Fuck that, I am T'Challa.
Put some respect on my name.
Basket in benevolence of black bastardry.
Can't copy the Cane Coach of Charisma.
Cam Newton meets Huey P. Newton in brains and bras.
This Jesus on the cross meets Jesus on the ark. I be the full spectrum of black shit.
to Salty Glen's old running man. The Mars, the Lion, Magic Bird, Philly, Mirror, Mansa, Musa. Have you ever seen a black man's outfit protecting from bullets? I got black boys everywhere.
Training in their gold chains.
We're vibranium.
A metal made of every sound.
Zor.
My people stay dread.
And drip out in their own invisible voices.
The Black Panther Party
came after the Black Panther comic.
Imagine what will happen when we show train to the silver screen. We will know Superman is as irrelevant as gold.
That the power. It's just a wannabe Afro pick. The MLK's secret identity
is Malcolm X.
Surprise, motherfucker. Look at me. I am the captain now. The real Dark Knight. Black Emperor. King of Kings. Network in the train. Let me buy the way that you're right.
Don't make me buy Gotham City.
Don't make me buy DC Comics Batman.
You just might be my sidekick in the making.
Marvel.
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 Ask this melon.
Okay. Amy said you were stupid enough to see. You don't need to know.
You should know Marvel so, by now. But they don't know, truth right there, were post-credit scenes with the next, plural. They don't deserve it. Nope.
Well, actually, Ricky down by me in the front actually bounced after the first cutscene. The old dude that was sitting next to the two young white dudes, he bounced ASAP, so I think they were getting on his nerves. But my whole role was very uncomfortable during the movie when Michael B. Jordan broke down how basically the white people was stealing stuff, claiming it as their own, when he was looking at the mask and the vibranium hammer. Yeah, Doc. Had a couple of white people cringe. Alright, so speaking to people, the women of Wakanda, describe them in one word. Mimi, you go first.
Got it.
One. Describe the women of Wakanda in one word. I would describe them as dangerous. So.
Beautiful. Beautiful and dangerous.
That is. That's it. I like it. I like it. That was nice. I see that. You've been getting better, bro. You've been getting better. All right. So. For those who don't know, the women of Wakanda stole the movie. Every aspect of it. They all kick ass. They're technologically smart. Did you know Siri's character is only 16 years old?
Wait, it's breaking up on my end. What?
Did you know that his little sister is only 16 years old?
And she probably is. No,
so that's smart at 16. Little comic book fact for those who don't know. She actually becomes the Black Panther for a brief moment in time. And she actually, the suit that she creates for herself actually lets her turn into a panther for a short period of time. So she kicked that. Definitely kicked that. Favorite scene in the movie? Juan, go first.
Alright. No, the big fight scene.
The Wakanda or any, one.
Anything when I'm going to kill my nigga. When he walked through with the big
robe on the screen, he was a nigga.
When he walked through with the big robe on and that big ass Black Panther fan. I'm like, oh, look at that motherfucker. Look at that big ass.
He did it like a pico. It was like two dudes in Wakanda that looked like the Migos. If you pay attention to the market.
I like this.
Mimi, favorite scene in the movie. Favorite scene in the movie. You've seen it three times. You have one by now.
What?
I'm serious. I love that movie so much.
Okay. So we'll slide. Just let me say the whole movie. Mine, honestly, I have to say, is the chase scene after the casino. I did not expect her to not be in the car, but still be able to control it.
Yeah, that was dope.
Siri's whole technological mind state was beyond fucking dope. Because I'm thinking about, like, what was the challenge like before? Because that
weirdo
scene
was
just too fucking dope. God, she killed him with one of those.
Mm-hmm.
The thing that made me laugh was she gave him some new shoes that make him walk quieter and called them sneakers. Like, that's not what they already called.
Because you sneaking up on my sneakers.
That's what made me laugh. I need them BP3s, bro. I want them.
But I called them.
Alright. Yeah, right.
You know, good.
Alright, so there was a moment in the movie when Akia, which was the head chick of the guard.
Her name was what?
So many words. Her name was what? Akia. O-K-O-Y-E.
Okay.
Michonne character. Okay. I'm going to say Michonne character. Where she had a conversation with Wakabi, which was her lover. They never said they were married, messing around. They were just lovers, as they called each other. And she had to choose between striking him down or doing her royal duty. Of course, she chose her job or the love of the country over him. If you had to go against the one you love, like or the one you date, the one you love, or stand up for your household, which one would you choose?
Well, it's different. She had the kind of battle to be loyal to the throne.
I know, but that's why I'm asking y'all with a kind of twist to the scenario. Because it'll be different from us.
If that's what my job is, then shit, you gotta know that when you get with me.
I felt like she was too loyal. Like, I dig it, but she's like, come on, bro. You just watched me throw your nigga over a ledge, man.
But that's just it. She said, like, she's loyal to the crown. It doesn't matter who's up there. She's loyal to the crown. Bro, you gotta remember, they went through some serious rite of passage to get that job. That's not just an application, dog. You see what the child had to do. Get the job, and it was his birthright. And he still had to go up there and fight for it.
My nigga, Zuko came down. The whole fox on his back.
If it hasn't already, but I bet you don't. You be getting shred the fuck up.
Oh, he be getting fucked without.
Because remember though. At the end of the day, he just has to win. He has to make the deal. The other niggas want the throne, so they gonna do everything. Like, that dude got stabbed at least 4 times.
Well, I want
him to man ain't stabbed him a couple times.
I want to say without the power of the general, Black Panther. Like, when he put the sip of the juice with a yak, he became a regular nigga.
But the funny thing about it is, in the comic books, even though he doesn't have his suit, he technically has hands. He's been training every form of martial art that there is out there. So he's good in hand-to-hand combat.
That's why I don't understand why he's getting his ass. He's supposed to be, like, amazing.
I think they did that. I think they did that to emphasize it. Like, you gotta actually have this nigga take some L's if you wanna believe Killmonger beat him for the throne. And then Man-Ape, that's actually his, has been his rival all his life. Bro's been wanting to fuck that nigga up for a minute. But shout out to him. Pay attention at the end. He's on the council.
The nigga said, no power, no claws, no special suit. It's just a boy.
But yeah, shout out to him. Okay, so we got to talk about the comic relief in the movie as well, too. It actually came in two forms. One was Siri and how she fucked with her brother. I did like the dynamics of that. They didn't make, you know, T'Challa all super serious. Like, him and his sister still had this bond that was probably going to be there forever. But the other one was the white guy. Only white guy they allowed in Wakanda, Ross. Do you feel like his character was like underutilized, overutilized? Was it necessary at all? Did they have just off that nigga?
I didn't know what purpose he served. Like,
he quit to watch that.
Well, in the comic, he is basically the Wakandan liaison. So he actually is the only person that is not of Wakandan descent, besides Storm, who can come and go in Wakanda because he communicates what's going on in the outside world, and he helped keep the white people at bay. That's his actual purpose.
Well, then that's cool.
In the comics, though, he a pussy-ass dude.
Well, he wasn't really about that life in the movie.
He's worse in the comics. You know that one scary ass nigga that Chris Tucker always seems to play in movies? That's him in the comics. Like, he down, but he always scared and gotta complain about it. That's Ross's character in a nutshell in the comics.
Like,
now, go ahead. I said, go ahead. You just gonna say something?
No, I said like Shaggy. How the motherfuckers always going on missions with the scary stuff.
That nigga be high 87% of the time when they start to be. I don't even think they tell that nigga going anywhere. I really think that's Freddy's brother. They just don't want to say it. Probably his van. No, that's probably his van, if you think about it. But no, the reason why I bring this up, because apparently there was outrage in the rice-skinned community that there was not enough representation of white people in this movie. On top of that, the LBG community was also upset that they had no representation in this movie as well. Do you feel that either one of these organizations... Do you feel either one of these organizations have a right to complain?
Leave us the fuck alone. That's what I feel like.
My whole thing is, you ain't gotta gay up everything.
You don't.
You already gayed up Black Lightning by making his oldest daughter be gay. Can't have Black Panther.
Well, gay people want everything.
They want every fucking thing. Like, they were upset. White people are actually upset that we as black people are out in droves to watch this movie, first of all.
Yeah.
All right. But to add on top of that, there are even our own people who is upset that not only are we out for this movie like this, but we are showing the fuck out in African garments, coming to America, Wakanda shirts, all kind of stuff. And black people feel like we should not be getting this ignorant for a movie like this.
Hey, look.
Right.
I get it, but I thought it was very... You don't get you Black Panther t-shirts, get you Black Panther hat. Hell, if you want to show us a movie just like the Black Panther, I am A-OK because that is what we are going to be. But niggas brought out niggas had on a kente cloth. They was wearing a head wrap. I was like, y'all do not
know. You didn't see the video I posted? There is somebody there's somebody that came to the Menominee Falls Theater, came out with his whole crew. They in the black, whole nine yards. He had a drummer, the whole nine yards, as he walked into the theater. But do you feel like that we doing too much stuff?
Yeah. Like, when you go up to the Black Panther stuff like King Joppy Joker, man, that is nowhere near the spectrum of this. Like, coming to America, still, Black Panther. It's too much.
Okay, it's African.
It's too much. Okay.
But do you feel like it's out of order? Because people were comparing it to, like, going to see Star Wars or going to see Harry Potter, that people were dressing up. You go to Harry Potter, you got robes on, you got people with wizard wands,
right,
putting lightning bolts on their forehead.
And that's the point, though. Like, if we go to see Harry Potter, it's 9 times out of 10 we're going to see people just like characters from Harry Potter.
Well,
young lady dressed like
the lady from Wakanda.
Cool, it has something to do with the movie.
But
don't dress like fucking Oprah Winfrey from the color purple and think that this is okay.
Okay. I was like, I'll give you that. Because I was going to say, the kente cloth and all that royal garment was what the people from Wakanda was wearing. So they wasn't doing too much there. Well, they had the style.
I didn't see no wood African medallion.
Let's see. What I'm saying was, think about it. Can you get the garments that they had on? Is that something easy to obtain? Kente cloth is easy to obtain. Every black-owned store got something like that. It's also Black History Month. So is they wrong for dressing up for Black History Month and going to see a black movie dressed like this?
Just a little bit. Just a little bit.
Just a little bit. So if it was the month of May, would this be an issue?
Because
I let it slide because it's Black History Month. That's why I let it slide. Now, if you go like that going to pick up the DVD,
people, sue me if you want to, but fake pro-black people are the worst people in the world. Nobody was screaming black power 6 months ago, but now we got a black movie star and a black film, all black cast. Everybody's like, oh, they're throwing the power fist up. Like, come on, bro. Like, nah, that's terrible, man. You wasn't pro-black. Come on, doing
that. That brings up another point. So, I seen someone rant about the fact that everybody's going crazy over the Black Panther movie, but nobody was making this kind of noise when Birth of a Nation came out. Where was all the excitement then? Let me set up Birth of a Nation first. For those who don't know what that is, it's basically the Nat Turner movie. Nat Turner was a guy during slavery who went out there and basically killed a bunch of slave owners to help free people. He wasn't successful because eventually he got cornered and killed. But a lot of people felt that we should have been more out there and excited for movies like that because it was real and it happened and it is actually part of our history, while Black Panther is just a comic book.
Hey, yo, Todd, I'm going to keep the G with you. I'm sick of slave movies, so I'm not supporting Birth of a Nation.
Hey, that's what I said. That was my reason. I just wanted to hear what y'all was going to say.
Like,
I'm sick of slaves.
I saw that on Facebook, and I think that was like that was such a reach. Like, you can't compare the two. Like, I feel like movies like, you know, the Black Panther or any comic book hero is uplifting. And, you know, I mean, yeah, it's fictional and nobody can be a superhero, but in a way you can be a superhero. And I think there's a message in most of, you know, comic book movies. It's all the same shit. You know, they all stand
always
for something, which as right, like they all stand for something. Inequality, they want justice, like, you know, and you can fight for stuff like that in your local neighborhood. But you can't go around killing slave masters. I don't want to be a slave master. Like, what the fuck? I'm not with that. No birth explanation. That Turner, you go burn somewhere. Okay, I'm sorry, that's probably too much. But
yeah, we always go overboard here anyway, so it's no big deal.
I mean, because I feel like Hollywood, or maybe not Hollywood, but I feel like it's only, like, they only give black people props when they playing a slave or they in some kind of compromising position, like
Holly Berry, like, getting bent over by
Bob Thornton was going to work on Hollywood.
Gave her an Oscar.
Man, slave movies was overrated. Like, I really hope that we pass that fad in Hollywood. Like, no more slave movies. Like, look, I get it. That's where our ancestors came from. But, I mean, niggas is owning businesses now. Can we have movies about that? Where's Master P. Fire? I want to see that now.
It's actually on its way. Not even trying to be funny.
I wasn't even trying to be funny. I'm dead serious. I want to see it. Let me
see if I can pull up the one I shared.
Well, me personally, I agree with everything you said, Juan. I'm sick and tired of slave movies. They feel like that's the only way we're supposed to be representative, because the title African American, Negro, or our actual storyline did kind of start with slavery, but it actually runs more deeper than that. I think people are also missing the key things about this movie, such as it's a predominantly white-owned company doing a movie that's about a predominantly black situation. We have black actors, we have black directors, we have an African country. Everything about it is something to be proud of, because it's a step in the right direction in Hollywood. And yeah.
And we're destroying the record. Right, and to piggyback off of what you just said, like, the Black Panther comic book came out in a time where it was still kind of, you know, racial and light.
Kind of, very much was.
Right. So for them to give you a depiction of white people who wrote the comic book and drew the comic book characters, for them to be like, we don't see black people in the light that y'all do, this is how we see them. It's a beautiful country. They got them out here living life like they got money in Wakanda, apparently. Like,
they got so much money. They the richest country in the world, bro.
Right.
Big fact. Don't nobody know. Comic books right now, Black Panther and Wakanda is so damn major that they have their own planet now.
So for them to, you know, depict black people in a positive light, I think it's dope. So, like, why they can, and that's another thing, the internet just don't know how to let people have that moment. Like, look,
people don't want nobody to be happy.
Chadwick Boseman is probably the blackest man in Hollywood right now, because there ain't a biopic he ain't in.
Right, it ain't killed it.
Right.
He played Thurgood Marshall. Bro, he played Thurgood Marshall.
James Brown,
you know,
Jackie Robinson.
Play a light skin. He played a god of Egypt. It's over.
Yeah, I'm with it. Chadwick Boseman. He got black guys. The internet just don't know how to let people be happy. I mean, focus on the positive points. Like, look, man, there's another movie and we saw Stan Lee. He ain't kicked the bucket yet.
Man, Stan Lee could have steal a nigga's chip, bruh.
Oh, like, his cameo would be so funny. Like, but yeah, I'm
they need to make they in phase four. In Marvel's phase four, if we still happen to have Stan Lee, his character should be a reoccurring character that happens in every movie. So instead of him playing weird roles, you just let it be one character that's there. So at the end of the day, it makes it seem like Stan Lee has been telling the story. Yeah.
It would be kind of dumb to see Stan Lee as like a narrator.
Right. Like at the end of the day, we find out Stan Lee is the one who's been telling these stories.
Right. So it's like, yeah, see, I can see that. Like, Stan Lee is a narrator. I mean, nobody's a great narrator anymore. Put that out there, but
not at all, sir. Bro, he's Prince God.
Only black man in Hollywood.
I don't know, dog. Samuel L. Jackson has done some good narration. That's just, yeah.
He's not better than Morgan Freeman.
No, he's definitely not better than Morgan Freeman. He makes you feel good about yourself every time he talks.
Now, if Morgan Freeman would have narrated Birth of a Nation, they probably would have wanted to go see it.
I fight you, I fight myself, I fight God, just tell me how many burdens left. I fight pain and hurricanes, today I wept. I'm trying to fight back tears, flood on my doorsteps. Life and living hell, puddles of blood in the street. Shooters on top of the building, government aid ain't relief. Earthquake, the body drop, the ground breaks. The poor run with smoke lungs and scarred face. Who need a hero?
Hero.
You need a hero, look in the mirror, there go your hero. Who on the front lines at ground zero?
Hero.
My heart don't skip a beat even when hard times bumps the needle. Mass destruction and mass corruption, the souls of suffering men. Clutching on deaf ears again, rapture's coming. It's all prophecy, and if I gotta be sacrificed for the greater good, then that's what it gotta
you
be.
Pray for me. Take my pain for me.
We didn't do a show that week when Monique became the topic.
I want to say that Chris Rock Netflix special is not really that great, but it's Chris Rock, so I'd have paid him too. But yeah, Monique.
Did you watch the Chris Rock special with black eyes, or did you watch it with white eyes? Because you got to remember, he gets white money, so his comedy is geared towards those people.
It was definitely more of white humor. Like, I understood I understood all the jokes. It just wasn't funny. As a black guy, I'm like, it's not funny.
Somebody said that. I'll check it out. I'll check it out. We'll critique it. We'll do it. Are we doing the show Thursday?
If me and Jazz ain't drunk.
Why would her y'all birthday. Be drunk on a Thursday?
Her birthday.
Oh, damn. I swear she just had a birthday.
Yeah, man, she'll be 21 or 20, one of them. Mm-hmm.
Tell her to come apply at Kohl's. You can get a job if she ain't got to travel that far.
Yeah,
so you ain't going to make it. We'll just have Jazz come apply. We'll split the money. We'll split the referral bonus. Huh?
You find it? Huh?
I'm just...
Yeah, but Monique was really mad that they only offered her $500,000.
Monique has been blackballed, too. Ever since she made that comment about Lee Daniels, Doug, and basically in so many words said that the role of Cookie was supposed to be hers, like, nobody listens to Monique anymore.
Let me ask you a question, Tom.
What's that?
I mean, because we just had this conversation. In the group chat, we were talking about black comedies, right?
Yeah, that was going to be where we was going next.
Was she on any of the movies on that? Was she in any of the movies on that?
I don't think so.
Monique.
Somebody else didn't make the list, too.
Monique is not really funny, though.
Like, somebody brought up the point that the last thing that she did stand-up wise to make her a relevant comedian was You Might Be My Cellmate. And we know how long ago that was.
That's on Netflix. It came out in like 2009.
Right. I know it came out before then. It came out a while ago. Okay. It might be 2009. It might be 2009.
Like, so your last stand-up on record that was filmed was 10 years ago. Your career highlight is the part. Your career highlight is the spinoff of Moesha,
right?
Which the show probably only got picked up because Countess Vaughn was funny.
But the counter argument to that was how fucking long did Dave Chappelle disappear?
But that's just it. It's the amount of attention Dave Chappelle pulls in compared to the amount of attention Monique pulls in is two different things.
But that ain't what was said. It was said, you ain't did nothing in 10 years. Like, okay, he hadn't either, so what was the point? So if that's the case, you omit that part from the argument.
But outside of Precious, okay, that was her moment. Outside of Precious, what other movie that white people would know?
But even if you take that off the table, like, okay, we take all the movies off the table, because Dave Chappelle really ain't did a lot of movies. I mean, most of the movies he did was all low budget. They'll never get a fucking Oscar. I mean, he was co-starring with Eddie Griffin.
True.
So if you take all that off the table about him, then movies and all that, and you just look at the stand-up comedy aspect, I guess it's the name value. Like, if you put Dave Chappelle's name on a marquee, it'll probably sell out. And that's what a lot of people are saying. Like, so, you know, like, for a fact, Amy Schumer is not really funny to me.
She's kind of Tom Green annoying.
Right, but she was on record for selling out Madison Square Garden twice. Like, I guess that's a big accomplishment for a stand-up. You sell out Madison Square Garden twice, and you have the number one movie in the country, even though you're not funny. So when Netflix approach you and they coming with the bag, she has some clout on her name, even if she didn't deserve what she got. Her name got it.
She was hot at the time.
Right.
She was hot for the moment.
So if Monique was selling out Madison Square Garden and, you know, she may have had a hot movie at the time, of course she would get the bag because she hot right now. I think Dave Chappelle got paid based off his name because he hadn't did nothing in so long. But then when he came out with the special, they delivered. Like, it wasn't like, oh, Dave Chappelle ain't funny no more. Like, they was funny.
True.
I ain't never really found Monique funny outside of what she did on the Parkers. But that's just me.
All right, but
I could be wrong.
But let's be honest. Did we find Dave Chappelle funny because it's Dave Chappelle? Or if somebody else did his whole routine, would that routine still been funny? Because that's how you have to look at it when it comes to stand-up. If Kevin Hart did his routine, would some of that still have been funny to you?
No. Because Kevin Hart is black comedy and Dave Chappelle is like white comedy.
I don't know he's 100% white. I think he can walk into white bars and it's okay.
But, like, when you watch have you seen the Netflix special that Dave Chappelle has done?
Of course I have.
Definitely.
Did you see the Def Jam, the Def Comedy Jam 25th special?
Now, see, them jokes he was telling at Def Jam, that was all nigga comedy.
That was pure.
That was all black comedy.
Like, dog sat there. And that's another thing. Monique turned down doing that. And I feel like that's when Black America gave up on her, because you would not be where you are.
Was Monique ever on Def Jam? I never remember
her being
on Def Jam.
Yeah, she was on Def Jam. If you watch it, they even show a couple of skits from her performance. So they showed her on there.
Hey, you know what? With her trying to boycott Netflix, low key, I think Netflix is going to be petty. I think people who are not even funny just want to start getting the bag just for no reason. Like, people who just terrible finna get paid just because she was like, y'all should boycott Netflix. Oh, you were telling
me. I honestly think it boils down to who a white America can recognize. Monique is not that recognizable in white America.
Joe and Guy Tori finna get $60 million apiece for Netflix specials.
Why, bro?
like, why?
I would rather see Carmichael than seeing the Tories. I'm just saying.
Hey, man, let's give Tony Rock $60 million. Hey, but if Tony Rock did have a Netflix,
Tony Rock's
funny,
though.
I wouldn't sleep on it. He's funny. I like Tony Rock.
Tony Rock funny. That's why I can't take the Everybody Hates Chris serious, because Drew was supposed to be him. And I can't see some of them jokes. I can't see Tony doing that. Even though he was a dude down the street making fake IDs on the TV show.
Yes, he was.
I don't know why he was making fake IDs, though, bro. Like, why? Why?
I'm mad that one white dude died from diabetes.
What? What? Who got diabetes?
From the break. The one white dude, the movie with him and Cole.
Oh, yeah, I know the break.
Didn't he die?
He died, I think. Yeah, I think he died.
He was funny.
I just said, I hate that one white dude died from diabetes.
You did say that. I'm sorry to hear that. I apologize.
I'm sorry to hear that.
I apologize. I'm highly upset that what's his name was in this movie, though? Dude from Family Matters? Eddie Winslow?
Yeah.
I was very upset about that.
That movie was funny. Lamont Bentley was in it, too. It was terrible.
Yeah. He was his other brother.
That nigga said, ha-ha, Dad got kicked out the house. He said, ha-ha, so I put my toothbrush in your ass. He was like, what is he doing?
Yeah, that's what he did to the little brother. What? Okay.
Now he got ass mouth.
that had to be like the only role that I didn't like Clifton Powell in. Because at the end of the day,
by like an averaging dick statue.
Yes. Yes. God, he got anally assaulted. And they left him. And he came back gay.
Yeah, they did. Mm-hmm. I think Gary Payton made a cameo in this movie too for no reason.
Yeah,
he did.
The way that nigga was stroking him for a hug, it's okay. It's okay. The fuck happened?
Oh, the part.
Yeah.
Hey, Cole was funny.
It's okay. The gimp though, dog. Why was he breakdancing like that?
Hey, yo, Mimi, I think if we show some people from Netflix, like all your Facebook posts, I think you can
you'll
get
a show.
I definitely think you get like a Netflix special.
Mimi honestly need a regular show. She need to be a mom with two kids, which is her actual real life, who is just struggling
terrible,
to making it on her own. Just let
terrible
Mimi
brothers
be Mimi.
Like us.
You got to have terrible brothers, dog. You got to.
Hello?
Yeah.
Yes, we're still here.
Oh. I thought I was like, damn.
All
the
rest.
It was a great show.
No, actually, we passed the timeline, but we still talk.
I think Mimi should do stand-up.
I don't know. Mimi, do you feel like you could do stand-up? Okay.
I don't like crowds of people.
I really feel like people who don't know you personally, but they only know you from Facebook, they don't really understand how funny even your posts that ain't meant to be funny, like I don't think they understand how funny you are. Cause like when you know somebody personally, like you don't read their stat just in your voice, you read it in how she was saying. And then like I know Mimi, she talked with her hands sometimes. So like I can just picture her
animated
point. Right.
Very. That's why you be good for TV because you so animated. I'm just saying. Okay.
I told her a long time ago we need a web show. She said no. She don't want to be responsible for people having a heart attack.
No, okay.
I'm laughing so hard.
No.
That's the reason why you need one.
In the future, I may consider a web show that would be all right. Because we can record it and then go about our business. But
right.
I can do stand-up because, like I said, one, too fucking hot and uncomfortable there. Then you have to be up there for a fucking hour. Okay? It's an hour. Being up there hot for people staring at you and having to keep motherfuckers engaged and all that shit. And I don't have no time for that shit for an hour straight. Everybody knows my attention span is not worth an hour. Like, that's too long.
But you start slowly, though. You start off like maybe 15 minutes and then you work your way.
Yeah, but see, then you have to have like, you got to have a bit, an act. People travel to different places to do the same routine. I'm not a routine person. I'm off the top of my head on what's going on and how I'm feeling at the moment. So my comedy is different because it's not a rehearsed kind of comedy. It's really what the fuck I'm feeling and going through at the moment. So it wouldn't work.
But that's the key thing. You would do something to get the ball moving, but then you go off into what changed. Like if you haven't paid attention to Dave Chappelle, he do that. He'll start off with a topic, and then he'll just start talking about something that just recently happened, and he'll go from there. So what
and
you can do is
I
what
also,
recently happened, start shifting it, or just have that segment where you just rant, and then that rolls because your rant be funnier than some regular joke, though. So that's how it works for you.
And I also think that...
That's because my rants have actual emotion behind them, and I'm not just talking.
And I think that, like, when people... Unrehearsed comedy is funnier than rehearsed comedy, because
like, it gives people something new. Like, because some people, like, they travel, just like how some people travel to go watch wrestling. Like, some people travel to see their favorite comedians, man. Like, I don't get why you would travel to see Kevin Hart in Milwaukee, then you go to see the same show in Chicago, because he's going to do what he did here there, and then he may have a show in
Sometimes
Indiana.
They switch
you go
it up.
To Indy.
Sometimes. Sometimes
cool,
they switch it up.
But I guarantee you that when, like, Kevin Hart's on tour right now, so I guarantee you if he stops in Milwaukee, 9 times out of 10, when he gets to the major city that he's going to film the special in, because it's a movie coming soon, you're going to hear some of them jokes that he did here in his specials. It's like, yeah, I just give us all new material.
As you should. That's why I can't keep rewatching certain stand-ups. So if I get to the point where I can keep watching your stand-up, to me, you definitely are a great comedian.
Oh, yeah,
like,
I definitely watched Dave Chappelle's special like 3-4 times.
I was
I'm like
the second Richard Pryor, Bill Cosby himself, Grown Little Man, and Tiffany Haddish's last one, or her only one. I can watch those over and over again. Because to me, they're just funny and they timeless. Okay? Especially Bill Cosby himself. As I got older and I started having kids, jokes that just go over my head before hit home right away. Like when he talks about how his wife gets to the point where every night she has to beat the kids and how she goes about doing it, I just think about Lily and Titi, and it makes me laugh because it gets to that point that at least once a week we have to beat them to go to bed. And that's why, like,
you know,
it's only certain comedians that can do that.
You know who I want to see if they could really do stand-up?
Who?
I want to see if Marlon Wayans can do stand-up.
You know what? I do, too. Because I actually watched the Marlon show today, and it's annoying.
You watched it.
I watched it. It's annoying.
I can't think of him doing stand up, but I'll make it hot.
I think he would be good because he's animated. Like, to me, I feel like he would be the most entertaining one out the family doing stand up because he's so animated. But Damon would be the funniest one.
Damon Wayans Jr. ain't that bad. He did stand up a couple times. He's not that bad. He's pretty funny.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. I feel like Damon would be the funniest because I just feel like his stories would engage you more. Like, Ken has always been sketch comedy to me, and Sean has just been the good-looking brother that just gets the girls because he licks his lip like LL, but not really that funny.
I think Marlon could do stand up. I mean, there's a lot. Everybody on Twitter say he's not funny, so I think that would be to prove a lot of people wrong that you can be funny for an hour.
I think he could do it.
I mean, if they give the Netflix specials to D-Rain Davis, they can get Marlon $60 million.
Yeah, true. All right, so before we get out of here, tonight we're going to do our top five. Because I don't think you gave yours in the group one. I don't think you did yours either, Mimi. Top five favorite black comedies.
Do they got to be like a pure comedy or a movie that I just found funny?
Just give your top five and we'll go from there.
Well, we do comedies, I would say. Friday. That's in everybody's collection. Everybody has the movie Friday.
Actually, Friday wasn't in mine.
I was going to say Friday's not. Friday was funny, but it's not in my top for comedies. Like, there are movies that I've watched a million times. Like, for me, and this may be weird to y'all, but Soul Man is in my top five. Because I laughed.
Soul Man was in my top five.
A million
times. Soul Man, I watched a million
times.
Yeah,
but
Soul Man
I look at it like movies. Well, maybe I only watched Friday a million times. That's the only fucking DVD we had at that point in time in life.
If it's still in your top five, I'm not saying like whoever you put in your top five is wrong. Because let's be honest, there are so many movies out there that it's going to take a while for you to get a true top five list?
So I would go Friday, Soul Man, Half Baked, Don't Be a Menace. Even though Half Baked probably would be considered black comedy, but that's just funny to me.
I'll let Half Baked slide. I'll let Half Baked slide because the main character and his girlfriend was African American. Because she ended up becoming Mona on Half and Half.
Facts. All we got four right now.
Did you get the message?
All right. Let me see if I can find a group and what all they said. All right. So, Mike, before he got confused, he added Girl Trips, Three Strikes, How High, Soul Man, and Harlem Life. All right. Twan had Life.
Don't be a menace. Was he saying Harlem Life? Did he mean Harlem Nights?
He said coming to Harlem Life. So I think he meant to say coming to America.
Yeah. That'd be my first movie because I watched that movie 100 times. That's like my favorite movie. Eddie Murphy. Coming to America.
Twan said Life, Don't Be a Menace, Friday, and Black Dynamite. Nicole said Life, Don't Be a Menace, Major Pain, Girls Trip, and Harlem Nights.
I say Major Pain. You can't do a top five.
See, that's what you said. That's what you said. Just go off the dome, and what you got is what you got for now. Monte said Don't Be a Menace, Next Friday, All About the Benjamin, Soul Man, and Double Take. I said
really?
Life.
Double Take?
I said Life. He said Double Take, Doug. Hey, that's his movie. I said Life, Black Dynamite, Harlem Night, Undercover Brother, and Pootie Tang. I'm sorry, Doug. Pootie Tang was funny to get in the end.
Still waiting on that sequel, Chris Rock. And I know you hear me.
Just saying. Dirty. I don't know. Dirty D, the dude who played Dirty D, he just turned 65 last week. I didn't know dude was that old. I'm waiting on Black Dynamite 2. Right, I'm waiting for Black Dynamite 2. Bro had a orphanage. How do you have a orphanage? Bro, do you understand the concept of a orphanage? On one side of the building, you got chicks selling that thing. On the other side of the building, you got homeless kids living there.
Equal profit.
I'm just saying, Doug. And all the chicks know karate. Terrible. All right, with that being said, people, we have gone well past our time. Make sure you guys tune in tomorrow and catch the Man Cave, 2 p.m. Central Standard Time. Juan, you going to be there or you got to be at work? Just going to go quiet on me? All right, he go. Fuck it. If he's there, he's there. So let's go ahead and end tonight's show like the only way we know how around here.
Now, to the end, now, so we go.